Coming up, we're going to have a tribute. I want to really honor Steve Hill and his ministry. It's 7:30 right now, and I'm going to play a clip, Alex. I just want to play a clip, and I want to read, and I'm going to take a couple calls and from our listeners. And
awesome.
But yeah, I want to read a little bit about who Steve Hill was. Can I do that?
Yes, definitely.
All right, Steve Hill. This is taken from his website. Obviously, I want to read what it says here. let's see, right here. From 1995 to 2000, Steve Hill served as the evangelist of the Brownsville Revival. The meetings drew over 4 million and more than 150 nations through the door of the Brownsville Assembly of God Church. During the five-year revival, hundreds of thousands wept at the altars, repented of sinful lifestyles, and gave their lives to Jesus. Lives were dramatically changed, marriages were restored, and addictions were broken as the gospel of Jesus was presented with clarity. After the Brownsville Revival, Hill and his evangelistic team continued to hold arena and stadium crusades around the world. He also served as a senior pastor along with his wife Jerry of the Heartland World Ministries Church in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. Hill founded the School of Ministry, a soul-winning, presence-driven ministry school, as well as the prodigalsonly.com, which is a website that encourages people to come back to God. It says, a mighty warrior has fallen. Earth is better for his life and the poor for his passing, writes John Jeffs on his Hill's Facebook page. May the Lord raise up 100 like him, that many will know the greatness of God, that our hearts will go out to his family in this time of sorrow. Heaven rejoices as the earthly battle ended, but the heavenly praises begin. Well done, good and faithful servant. Mm. I'm going to pray. I want to play a clip. And I really want everybody, as you're listening, just to listen. Let your spiritual ears be opened. And I pray that you're blessed.
David should have been at war, but instead he was on the balcony of his house watching a woman bathe. He lusted over her, called his people, said, go get her, I want her. He took her, had sex with her, and then he realizes that he's in a big mess. This girl gets pregnant. He's got to do something about this. So Uriah, the Hittite, who is the husband of Bathsheba, David brings him in, wants him to lay with his wife and, you know, sort of fix things. Boy, we try to fix stuff, don't we? From the very beginning, we sowed fig leaves. From the very beginning, we try to fix our sin, try to cover up our sin. You can't cover it up. You got to get it washed clean. God's got to take care of it. So Uriah the Hittite, eventually, David sends him to the front line and has the husband killed. Okay, so now David is an adulterer and a murderer. And in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1, look at this. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David, prophet. And he came to him and said to him this story. There were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb which he had bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man who refused to take from his own flock to prepare one for the wayfaring man who had come to him, but he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come. Prophet of God, telling a story. And the sinner, listening. So David's anger was greatly aroused against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this shall surely die.
and he shall restore fourfold for the lamb, because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your keeping, and gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, I also would have given you much more. Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? You have killed Uriah the Hittite. Oh, I love prophets. And I love preachers of righteousness. I love pastors who are not afraid of their people. I love pastors who are not ashamed of the whole truth. I love pastors who will call sin, sin. Even if it means losing the biggest giver in the church. I love pastors. Dear Jesus, some of you are watching at home. The reason you're not happy is because God's not happy. The reason you're not happy, and you got all kinds of stuff, but you're not happy with yourself because you've wavered. And the truth has been set to the side. You just give enough truth to make the people happy, but you don't share the whole truth. Nathan, as he's sharing this, David could have pulled out a sword and sliced off his head. Shut up, Nathan. Get out of my life. This is David. Man of God. King. Help us. Jesus, help us to return to the God of our fathers.
That was so powerful.
Yes, it was.
That was so powerful.
I hope you guys enjoyed that. Yeah. What can
I do for you? For those of you that just logged on or just are listening, you know, that was Steve Hill.
You know, he was just really making a declaration of just the righteousness and being steadfast and being stern. And there was just so much in that one little clip. I'm going to go to the line real quick, and I've got somebody on the line that wants to share. A friend of ours, James Gall, who knew Steve Hill. Stand by.
I'm with Encounter Network and Prayer Storm out of Franklin, Tennessee. And it's with both sadness and joy that I heard the news that my dear friend and the friend of God, Steve Hill, graduated into heaven a couple of days ago. And let me tell you about the first time I met this infamous evangelist, Steve Hill. I was ministering in Linville, Tyler, Texas at a prophetic conference in March of 1995, and a good-looking man with every hair in place and a red silk tie and bright shiny shoes and a suit came up to meet me, and I was not dressed like him. And he was sent to have me pray for him. so I did. And I looked in the spirit, and I saw a new launching pad being built and established for this man. I knew it was in the state of Florida, and I saw scriptures that were written on this missile. I don't recall what they were at this time, but and then I saw fire be lit under this missile, and it circled the globe. I believe, if I remember right, it circled the globe for like 5 times. And then, and I started declaring to him, the Lord is preparing a new base for you. And soon, a fire will be lit under your life that will go around the world. He didn't bat an eye. I wasn't sure if he liked what I had to say or not. Later, just a few weeks later, that same spring, summer, in June, for a one-time meeting on Father's Day, Brownsville, Assembly of God, Pensacola, Florida. This was the man that the fire was lit under, and the rest is history. Steve Hill and I ended up becoming friends after that point. We had never had known each other up to that time. And fire was lit under that man, and it went around the world. He and I ended up becoming friends partially because of the things we suffered. Because of knowing Jesus and as well, and believing for a global revival, and because our lives were both touched by cancer. I went through 8 years of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Dear Steve had his serious battles with melanoma. So we ended up sharing, praying for one another on the phone, helping each other what we could, and just being cheerleaders for one another in our common journey. I want to give honor to whom honor is due. And I want to say, well done, Steve Hill. You go down in my book as one of the great modern heroes of the faith. You inspired many. You say, by Jesus' grace, were used to help bring hundreds of thousands to salvation, missions around the world, a man of integrity, a man who loved his wife and his children well. Today, with both joy and sadness, I say, I was touched by the light and the shadow of one of the fieriest evangelists that this generation has ever known. And I thank the Lord for the life, the lineage, and the legacy of Steve Hill. Heaven rejoices, but we pray for Jerry and the family, for the comfort of God to come close to them, as we with them honor and give tribute to one of the greatest evangelists this generation has ever known. Thank you. God bless you. And we thank the Lord for the life and ministry of Steve Hill. Amen. God bless you.
That was amazing. I mean, it was just so awesome. The friendship that they had, the things that they were able to just call each other up and just be there for one another.
Yeah, and if you might have just tuned in, that was James Gall. And where he was talking about Steve Hill, who just passed and went to, I like the way they say it, he just graduated to be with the Lord.
I love that.
And so we just want to honor him. And we're going to take some more callers. We're going to go back to a song here. But in just a moment, we're going to take a couple more calls of people who have really were impacted by his ministry. You know, it's just powerful. Really powerful.
Yes, it's great to hear these stories. They're awesome.
You're listening to Radio Jesus, and we'll be right back. Amen. Welcome back, man. Thank you so much for being tuned here live on RadioAirJesus.com. Here live on 91.3 The Fix FM. We pray that you have been blessed by the programming today and just everything that God's been doing today. It's been really, really amazing. We're tributing Steve Hill, an awesome man of God who God used in such a powerful way. We have a caller on the line today, and somebody who walked with him personally and has a firsthand experience, and actually the music that you hear in the background, it's Aaron Kreider. Aaron, are you there, Aaron?
I'm here. It's great to be with you.
Hey, man. Thank you so much, Aaron. We really appreciate you, and we're just so happy to have you with us here on Radio Air Jesus, man. And Aaron, tell us a little bit about you and Steve, bud.
Well, you know, Steve Hill, it was, you know, a good friend of mine. And, you know, my heart's heavy today, not for him, but for his family, for Jerry and the kids. And heart goes out to them, and been praying for them all day, just since I heard the news last night. But, you know, my relationship with Steve goes all the way back to Brownsville days. My wife and I had the privilege of serving at the Brownsville Revival in Pensacola, Florida. We lived there for about 8 years in Pensacola, all the way through the Brownsville Revival days. And we served right alongside Steve, and you know, in the altars. I was, of course, we were on the worship team and served in that capacity as well. And I went through the school, graduated from the Bible school there, the Brownsville Revival School of Ministry. But some of my favorite times with Steve were in those altar times, where we would be praying literally for hours every night for thousands of people who came from all over the world and were giving their hearts to the Lord, rededicating their lives to the Lord, and just being touched by the power of God and changed. And I can tell you, something that I'll never forget is something that Steve would say every night, and then things that he said to me personally in our time together personally, is one sentence. He would say, "Are the things you're living for worth Christ dying for?" Wow. And not a message would go by where he wouldn't, with tears streaming down his face, just passionately say that to the crowd, to the congregation. And then with me personally, just recall recently, in fact, it was the last time I spoke to Steve. He said to me on the phone, we were speaking on the phone, and he said to me, Aaron, what you need to do is, he said, draw a circle around your life. First of all, Steve was always, he's so encouraging to me. And it was on that phone call, you know, for a man like Steve Hill to say what I'm about to tell you to me is just absolutely incredible to me. But he said, "Aaron, you're my hero." He said, "You're one of my heroes."
Wow.
And he said, you're a future general. And I don't say that to boast, but I say that just to give you a picture of what kind of a mentor and a father he was. He was always pouring into his spiritual sons and building them up, which is the way it should be. And I remember him saying that to me and encouraging me, and then he challenged me, as he always would. He said, "Aaron, I want you to draw a circle around your life." He said, "Draw a spiritual circle around your life." And he said, "Let that circle be a circle of integrity. Let that circle be a circle of non-compromise." And he said, "Let that circle be a circle of radically, radically serving Jesus and winning the lost." And he said, "Never step outside of that circle. Whatever opportunity that comes your way," he said, "whether it's millions of dollars or fame and fortune," he said, "never, if it calls you outside of that circle, never step outside of it. Turn it down." And he said, "Always remember, are the things that you're living for worth Christ dying for?" That was the last time I spoke to him. And those were the words that I remember him challenging millions at the altar at Brownsville with, and those were the words that in his last days he was still personally challenging me with. And we've lost a general. We've lost a general. He was just a powerful man of God, lived with absolute integrity, and challenged you with integrity. In fact, it was on that phone call that he said to me, he said, "Aaron," he said, "we have a problem in the church today." And he said, "The problem in the church today is that we have preachers that won't preach against sin, and we have congregants that feel like they can live their lives however they want because of grace." And he said, Aaron, I'm challenging you. Draw a circle of integrity and no compromise around your life and stay within it. He said, always preach the cross. Always preach the gospel. And he said, stay within that circle. And he would just challenge me. He always challenged me. Always build me up. And I miss him terribly. And we've lost one of the greats, that's for sure.
Wow. You know, I mean, just in that sentence that he shared with you on the last call, that's profound, bro. That is just so powerful. You know, and I grabbed that word for myself, and to draw a circle around me of integrity, you know, and never want to do anything that would be not of the character and nature of Christ. And
Right.
You know, Aaron, I thank you so much for allowing your time to share with us just your heart with about Steve, and you're right, he's an amazing man of God, and he impacted many people.
He did. Millions.
Millions, you're
millions
right.
Millions on every continent. And it wasn't you know, the thing about Steve, there's lots of famous people that impact lots of people. And even lots of, you know, famous ministers and preachers that impact lots of people. But I've never known a man who impacted more people with just the simple message of the gospel, which is repentance, the cross, and living their life for Jesus like Steve did. He really, really just preached the simple message of repentance and the cross. And again, you know, one of the last times that I was with him in person, I remember specifically him saying to me, he said, and this was in classic Steve Hill form, he said, we've got too many Christians who are drunk on wine and not drunk in the Spirit. And he said, again in that time, he challenged me again. He said, I'm challenging you, son. Draw a circle and stay in it. Don't get outside. Don't compromise. Preach the cross. And I just want to challenge anyone who's listening right now. I mean, you know, Steve's in heaven. He's with the Lord. He won. He finished the race and he won. But his voice still reverberates right now. And I just want to challenge anyone that's listening. If in classic Steve Hill form, if you're living a compromised life, if you're living a life where you know if Jesus were to walk in the room, you would have to drop to your knees and repent. Are the things you're living for worth Christ dying for? I want to challenge you with that. And if they're not, Steve's voice reverberates today. He would say, then cut it off. Cut it off. If what you're living for, if what you're living in isn't worth Jesus giving his life for you on the cross, cut it off and give your life to him. Sell out. I just want to challenge you with that.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Aaron. Don't go anywhere. Stand by, brother.
Amen.
Yes, everybody, just that's the challenge right now, just to make it right, you know, and that's amazing. Draw that circle right now around your life. Walk in integrity. Walk in the character of Jesus and see everything just fall in place. Don't go anywhere. You're listening to Radio Air Jesus here live on 91.3.
The Fix.
Welcome back. Thank you so much for being tuned in here at Radio Air Jesus and 91.3 The Fix. We hope you guys are being blessed by all the powerful testimonies and just the music, the worship, the presence that's in the atmosphere right now. So we just, you know, we just thank you for hanging in with us, because I know it's been really, really powerful and amazing. For those who might have just tuned in, we've really been speaking about Steve Hill and honoring an amazing man of God that went to be with the Lord yesterday, March the 9th. And he's gone to be with the Lord, and we just love how they say he's graduated and he's gone to the heavens to be with our Father. And we're speaking with we just had James Gall with us, and he spoke a little bit about Steve Hill, and then we just had Aaron Kreider, and now I've got a pastor from Destin, Florida. Ben, are you on the line?
Yeah, I'm here, Pete.
Hey, Ben, how you doing, buddy? Are you doing all right?
Doing good.
Man, so what do you think, Ben? What do you think about what you've been hearing on the radio here?
Well, everything that I've been hearing is just one of the many layers that Steve Hill is made up of. I remember my first encounter with Steve Hill was in October of 1995. We ended up going to the revival because I had somebody who had been just irritating me, telling me to go to this church. And I ended up going to the church just to make the person quit talking to me about God, quit talking to me about church. And I grew up in church and lived a lifestyle of drugs and alcohol and had no idea that it was wrong. And go to this church and walked into Brownsville, sat in the back row, and started to hear Steve preach. And there was something different about his message. There was a presence that was on his message, and there was a convicting power that just really permeated the atmosphere. And, you know, I looked around, and there were different things that were happening that were common and normal in the revival. You'd see people trembling under the power of the Spirit. So I remember I ended up leaving because I ended up becoming so convicted, I left the service. And somebody found me later on that evening during prayer time, and they said, come, you need to get prayed for by Steve Hill. And I didn't believe in anything that was going on in the revival. And so my friend took me and pushed me towards the front to get prayed for by Steve Hill, and he walked up to me, and he looked at me in the eyes. And that's the one thing that I can say is I'll forever remember those eyes. And they were so piercing but so full of love. And he prayed for me, and the power of God hit me. And, you know, I'll never forget that day, because it's there's something about a man of God who has a touch upon his life like Steve. And after the Lord had touched me that day, I remember getting up off of the floor saying, God, I might not know everything, but I know that this is you and this is a man of God. And over the course of the revival, I really began to just listen to Steve and listen to his life story, and some of the testimonies and the stories that he shared really captured me. And it wasn't necessarily what Steve was at the moment, but how he became who he was and where he had come from. And that's really what grasped me. And I remember Steve telling stories about how when he was freshly saved, being delivered from a heroin addict. And the first thing that he did is he began to study the old men of God. And he used to study guys like Finney and Jonathan Edwards and D.L. Moody, Leonard Ravenhill, and he had some incredible mentors. But I know that even if Steve Hill's passed on, he's kind of like one of those generals that we today, we've got to dig down into what he's left here for us to really pick up and carry on. And, you know, I got to say with Aaron, one of the things he said over and over that I totally agree with is he said that Steve was 100% about integrity. And he was in Argentina. He shared the story. He was in Argentina, and he got an offer to pastor a very prestigious church, making a very good income, having a house and a car and everything. And they were living in pretty poor conditions. And because Steve followed the Lord and his obedience to the Lord and saying no to fame and fortune, he said yes. And one of the things Steve used to always say at the revival is he said, religion is hanging around the cross. Christianity is getting on the cross. And I'll tell you, if Steve was a man that knew how to carry his cross, and, you know, on the drive home today, Pete, I was talking about Leonard Ravenhill because Steve used to always talk about Leonard Ravenhill. And Leonard Ravenhill, he preached about revival his whole entire life, and he never got to see it. And Leonard Ravenhill, I think he died just right before the revival happened. And Steve said from the platform, he says, you know, I don't think that we did anything to deserve this revival. And he said that unless a seed goes into the ground and dies, it cannot bear forth fruit. And I remember last night, I just heard this news of Steve passing on, and I said to the Lord, I said, God, you know, it just grieves my heart so much to hear of a passing of a
great man of God. And the Lord said that same thing against him. He said, unless a seed dies and goes into the ground, it cannot bear forth fruit. And I know this, is I know that Steve is a seed that he's sown into this earth and he's sown into different people's lives. And I know that there's something that God wants to release, and there's seeds of revival that are all over the world now.
Wow, yes.
Maybe some are dormant right now, but God's getting ready to breathe on them again. And so maybe there's some people listening right now, and they're in that process, and they're saying, you know, God, I remember getting touched at the revival, and I'm longing for revival, and, you know, this passion of Steve is sparking that again, because they're remembering. And, you know, I just want to just release that over the radio here for every person who's had whatever kind of impartation or touch that you've received from Steve, from the revival. Your waiting time is coming to a close, and your time is now.
And you know, not just with Steve, but even in any impartation that you might have received in any gathering. You see,
yeah.
I mean, it's man, it's so powerful. So yeah. Powerful. And I believe that. I believe what you said. And he took it, he with his passing, the seeds will be multiplied and many will be risen up. A new generation of the breed of prophets will arise. The pastors, the preachers, the teachers, the evangelists are going to be arising, and they're going to take their place in this time.
Oh, come on.
So powerful. Ben, thank you so much, Ben, for calling in, for being a part of the program this evening, and God bless you, bro. You're awesome. Thank you so much.
Amen.
All right.
Love you,
babe. All right, you too, brother.
Bye.